You want the link so you can share it for the live stream?
Yeah, that would be great.
All right, give me 1 second.
Yeah, that would be great.
All right, give me 1 second.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
It was so weird. I didn't have my mic on the whole time. There we go. I'm going to have to kill the volume on that. Okay, so I'm going to send you the link inside the chat box here.
Okay.
Oh, maybe not. Let's see. There you go. Right, let's give it to everyone in Twitter world. Twitter. What's your Twitter handle?
Underscore CN14.
Those underscores that always get me. CN14?
Yeah.
That's it?
Yep.
You say so. There you go, it is you. All right, you ready, Christian?
Yeah, just making the post real quick.
Bad walk-up tune.
Thanks, Chris.
All right, so I think you're the smartest person I've talked to in a while. Graduate of MIT Sloan. How was that? How was MIT?
Great, so my MIT was actually a certification that I took during my undergrad while I was attending school at UCSD. And essentially what my main reason for taking this course was to be on top of the learning curve when it comes to blockchain and be an innovator and a pioneer in this new technology, especially here in the US.
Who ran that program? I think it was, wasn't it something Joe Ito?
I guess like my main professor, so I had multiple professors throughout the course. My main professor was Christian Catalini, who is the head economist of Facebook's Libra, which is now renamed Novi, as well as the co-founder of Algorand.
Wait a second, hold on. Libra, his name?
No. So his name is Christian Catalini.
Uh-huh.
He's the head economist and co-founder of Facebook's Libra.
Yeah, I know what Libra is. And then what did you say after that?
So one of the other professors was, he's a co-founder and CEO of Algorand.
Oh, wow. So you had some interesting people teaching you about the blockchain.
Right. Yeah, it was a very rigorous course.
Was it a technical course?
The title is Blockchain Technologies, Business Innovation and Application. So it's mainly a business course, however, technical enough to for me to be able to do like due diligence on projects, reading white papers, understand the efficacy and the team, essentially.
You know, I've read so many white papers over the last 5 years, 4 years, that really what they start off with in their white paper and what the project ends up becoming, in many ways, it's just so deviated that when you read a white paper, you almost have to read about the team and focus on that part, because so many white papers don't even have the talent sometimes to actually execute what they're saying they're going to. It's amazing when you read some of the white papers and what they ended up doing and not doing. And ultimately, I think what I've found is it breaks down 100% of the time to the team behind the white paper. It's always,
yeah, I agree. Yeah, I definitely agree. You know, it definitely takes leadership to one, launch a startup, and two, launch a startup in such a innovative, like, you know, brand new era of, you know, what's the blockchain, right? So it's extremely new, and you know, speaking to regulators and trying to speak to you know, to your target market, and, you know, go over like the Chasm bill and try to get, like, you know, the adoption. It's already difficult within itself. So it definitely comes down to the leadership team.
So how's San Diego?
Amazing. Yeah.
Hanging out there surfing every day?
I've actually never surfed. That was the idea of like coming to San Diego, and I just have never done it.
You gotta go surf. You go check out my friend, the All American Dave. He's probably, not probably, he's definitely the best surfer I know.
Okay.
He surfs like people go for walks and hikes.
And he's located in San Diego?
He's all over. He spends a lot of his time in Fiji. He's right now in Vegas. Saw him surfing last night on Lake Meeb. He does the whole behind the boat surfing. I don't even know what that's called. What is that? Trail surfing? Or
I have no idea.
You ever see it when like they have a boat and the boat creates waves and they're surfing? Oh,
okay. Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Don't ask me. I haven't done it yet. The whole surfing is a little tough. Yeah, so you're working on something that's pretty interesting, and that's why I reached out to you. It's Cybermane. Let's talk a little bit about it.
Yeah, so, you know, the model is essentially interconnecting the data that runs the world. Cybermane is essentially a hybrid of blockchain and decentralized ledger technology. Essentially, the team has figured out that, or the problem is, blockchain is very difficult to scale when trying to validate large data sets. So we're here speaking about big data.
The blockchain doesn't work well with data.
Exactly. So we've created, we have our own protocol, which is a DAG protocol, which stands for Directed Acyclic Graphic. And essentially what it does, so just hence like the name Cyber Vein, it runs like a vein in our system, right? So it essentially validates data in parallel. And by doing so, it can naturally solve the scalability issue. And essentially, run large data sets and...
Oh, wait a second. So it verifies data, but where's the data stored?
So it's a decentralized technology. So the data is stored through different nodes. We have a consensus model. And right now the goal is to try to have as much nodes as we can through academia. So by having academia, they can, you know, have the credibility of securing and validating our data.
So think about this for a second. You've got all these nodes, but eventually data eats up the world. I mean, the more data you get, there's going to be a limited supply of storage within these nodes, correct?
Right. Yeah. So we also have our own like data centers. And essentially that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to expand like the ecosystem within the data centers and be able to help
Yes, he's trying to expand the ecosystem of the Amazon truck driver coming to my house. All right, Jesse just got his cameo appearance.
Nice. So we've created essentially what it's called Dave, and Dave stands.
What's it called?
Dave.
You gave it a name.
Yeah, so we gave it a name, and Dave stands for Data Analytics Valuation Exchange. So we've gone ahead and now we're creating some sort of like marketplace where you can actually monetize and share, you know, your data sets and your algorithms. And essentially what this will do is increase innovation, right? Now you can actually share your data sets, share your algorithms. Someone else can go ahead and buy them and we don't have to start reinventing the wheel.
So in many ways, your project does have a centralized aspect because you're storing the data inside your own data center, correct?
Right. Correct. However, like these data centers, like the data that's being validated will be through a consensus model with academia. So, you know, essentially, it is going to be decentralized and we are going to have multiple parties validating this data.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think centralizing data in a blockchain project is a bad thing. I'm just trying to understand exactly how you're doing this because eventually, you know, data just eats up so much space. So you, in many ways, I thought you kind of had to almost centralize the data, because the way the blockchain works is it doesn't have a lot of data involved. And in most cases, data slows down most blockchains. You guys are building your own blockchain, correct?
Right. So we're currently an ERC-20 token as of right now. But our goal is for next year to...
That's your trading token. Are you guys building your own blockchain to store all this technology?
We are, yes. So the mainnet would be launched next year. And that's part of our, our agenda.
So you guys are early on. You got a ways to go. Where's your team? Is it distributed all over the planet?
As of right now, yes. It's incorporated in Singapore. We have a team in China. And
shout out to my favorite country in the world, Singapore.
Singapore. You know, Singapore is actually a country that I'm like that's on my bucket list.
Oh, listen, let me tell you something. I've been there 3 times. The people are amazing. And Singapore is one of the most beautiful countries architecturally. They have amazing architectural structure. And their buildings, listen, let me tell you something. If I were you, I'd start looking for tickets right now. I bet you it's cheap as hell to fly to Singapore right now.
Right. Yeah, no, I agree. The only thing that I was told about Singapore, if you're going to go, like, make sure you add 2 extra weeks into your schedule because you have to quarantine the minute that you get there.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Fuck that shit. What are they going to do? Like, have the quarantine police follow you everywhere?
I have no idea how that works.
I just, wear a bubble outfit or something. This whole quarantine stuff is just fucking annoying. Like, it's amazing. There's 2 things about this whole scamdemic, and I'm calling it a scamdemic because I've become a coronavirus MD by now, that there's nothing about this thing that screams that we should be having these kind of reactions to it. But you look around, coronavirus it's a virus and it hops around to people, but as human beings, the average man lives till like 69. The average woman lives till 74. The average person dying of COVID is 80 and a half years old. Listen, if I die at 80 and a half years old, if COVID doesn't get me, it might be me falling out of bed in the morning or getting hit by a truck or, pneumonia or some other thing. Once you've lived 80 and a half years on this planet, you've probably lived a pretty good life,
Right.
So it's so crazy, all this, quarantine. Come on, man. All right, so we got a guest appearance.
Okay.
This is what I call my bone chain, and Jesse likes to mine bone chain. Jesse, you say hi?
Jesse.
You want to say hi, buddy? He's like, just give me the bone! Just give me the bone! God, give me the bone! So, yeah, so Singapore, when you go there, I'm telling you, you'll love it. You'll absolutely love it. It's architecturally, it is an amazing country. They have some really amazing sight lines of the buildings. The marina, they got a beautiful marina there. Super amazing place. You'll love it.
Yeah, I mean,
crypto's huge in Singapore.
Exactly, and because I'm this technologist, I want to call myself. Singapore is at the forefront of innovation. They're already transacting with digital currencies. They're already using blockchain for traceability purposes. So it's definitely an ecosystem that I would like to indulge myself in, and essentially learn from sociological and psychological effects of being at the forefront of innovation, and not being afraid to be open-minded and having essentially technological solutions be a part of the everyday life.
Now listen, you want to make a shit ton of money?
Yeah.
When you go to Singapore, pack in your suitcase, mogs and mogs of fucking chewing gum. You'll be able to sell that shit at fucking 100x.
Is that because chewing gum is banned?
Banned. Can't get it anywhere. I went to the hotel gift shop and I wanted some chewing gum. So I'm like, I look at the lady behind the counter. I'm like, hey, where's the chewing gum? I see mints and chocolates. And I'm like, yo, lady, where's the chewing gum? She's like, whoa. I'm like, what are you talking about? Well, relax. Chewing gum. Chewing gum? She goes, yeah, banned. No chewing gum. I'm like, are you kidding me? So we get inside of one of these they don't have Uber out there. They have this thing called Grab. Same thing, basically Uber, but, you know, Singapore's version. And we get in the car, telling the driver about the chewing gum. He like pulls out a little box of fucking chewing gum. I think it was cinnamon, which I normally don't like cinnamon, but I wanted chewing gum that bad. And he's like, yeah, I went and got it across the border. Here, it's hard to get. Take a piece. And I'm like, fuck yeah, it's delish. So yeah, it's crazy. They got rid of chewing gum because I guess people were putting it under the benches and the subways. They just didn't like chewing gum everywhere, which actually is kind of interesting. I mean, I get that. And it adds to the beautification of the country. The country is very focused on being beautiful. And I think they've accomplished that. I think Singapore is going to become the new Hong Kong, because what's happening in Hong Kong with the Chinese, I don't want to say takeover, because they basically own it from the British pretty soon, but what's happening in Hong Kong is pushing a lot of the big financial companies out of Hong Kong and into Singapore. I think if you watch, Singapore will become the new financial hub of Asia, or at least one of the new financial hubs of Asia.
Right. I mean, they do have amazing regulation, to my understanding. You know, when it comes to like digital currencies, you know, innovation. So I don't doubt it. I believe that, you know, the Singaporean country is.
Is that what it is? Singaporean?
Or the country of Singapore. you know, it's definitely going to be like one of the main drivers of innovation, probably for the next 10 years and so on.
Maybe. I wouldn't turn your back on Russia. I think Russia and China, you see, one thing that blockchain does is it takes government out of money.
Right. And
if you look at what's happening with the blockchain right now, that people are, I think, ignoring a lot of, is it's now taking away a little bit, not a lot, but it's taking it away a little bit every day. It's taking away the US dollar standing as a global currency.
Correct.
And I don't know if Bitcoin is going to be a global currency, even though it already is. But I think what you're going to see is countries are going to build their own digital currencies, and they're going to use those currencies to transact with other countries. And for example, you know, Russia sells a ton of oil. China sells a ton of everything. North Korea can't sell jack shit because they've got these embargoes. But if you think about it, I bet you they've been working around these embargoes by through the use of Bitcoin.
Right. No. So I've actually had read an article where a lot of their funding comes from cyber attacks, specifically from Bitcoin.
I read that too. And maybe they've got this like big, you know, hacker building full of hackers, but I think a lot of their cyber attacks, as everyone calls it, comes from phishing expeditions. People fall for, hey, you know, this is an email from a buddy of yours that had his email hacked, and by the way, click on this link and send me some fucking BTC. I think people make hacking to seem like this big, like super, like I can sneak into your system and steal all your Bitcoin. 90 plus percent of all hacking experiences are social engineered.
Right.
So, I mean, the whole, and that type of hacking that North Korea is doing, it's basically thievery. They're just stealing Bitcoin and they're convincing people to do stupid shit.
Right.
Which, by the way, if I send you an email saying, send me Bitcoin, call me first and verify it's me.
Okay.
So let's get back to Cybervan, because I get it, and it's the use of data, and there's some interesting things that you mentioned, Singapore, but I think in North Korea or South Korea, they're doing some interesting, I want to say they're doing it with the blockchain, but I could be wrong, in COVID tracing. What's it called when they trace?
Contact tracing.
And I think your platform could do things like contact tracing.
So our platform is essentially more focused on just big data sets. So AI, machine learning, right?
Contact tracing, that's a big data set, you know, people.
Correct. Right. There may be that use case for contact tracing. However, like we would essentially have to look at like the amount of data and like how we would essentially be, going upon such project. But for example, when it comes to COVID, a great use case for Cybergreen would be, so right now we have all of these pharmaceutical companies trying to develop a vaccine. And never before in like the history of like pharmaceuticals did we have applications such as like AI and machine learning to actually run data sets at an extraordinary amount of speed to be able to do trial and error, essentially, right? So that's essentially like what machine learning looks like. It's a lot of trial and error.
Are you talking about trial and error on the drug tests or the vaccine tests?
Trial and error on the sense of the vaccine, like, does this work? No, this doesn't work. Okay, does this work? And then essentially finding a path forward.
Well, centralizing all that testing data is decentralizing it is important. But here's the crazy thing. All these countries that are working on this vaccine, they're not sharing their knowledge in even a centralized fashion. They're all competing.
Right. And
it's crazy because if you think about it, if the goal is to find a vaccine, decentralize or upload the data to a centralized platform, but share the data, open source the data.
Exactly.
But they're not doing that. It's the stupidest thing I've ever seen.
Right. And so let's, and maybe it is because there isn't, a solution such as Cybergreen where they can actually monetize their previous data sets. Let's say the data sets that got them to step one and now they're in step five. So realistically allowing for the rest of the ecosystem to be in par in step one, step two, that's what essentially like something like Cybergreen.
Yeah, but they're not going to monetize that data as much as they would monetize getting first to market with a vaccine. That's what they're all trying to get their grubby little hands all over is that first, 100 million orders or 300 million orders of a vaccine where they make billions of dollars, probably more than that. Probably, I bet you the drug company that comes up with this is probably going to make close to $500 billion.
Right. No, I agree. And whoever does solve the vaccine, they're going to get a pretty nice check.
Get nice checks. Look at yesterday. I think yesterday the government bought 750 billion or million. I can't remember what it was. Yeah. It might have been $750 million worth of tests, rapid tests for COVID, right. 5-minute tests. And it's crazy because, everyone's racing to get a vaccine. We don't have a vaccine for the fucking flu. You think I want to get injected with something that was rushed that quickly? I mean, come on, man. Are you crazy?
Right. So, that's one use case.
That's why I think decentralizing that, open sourcing that information would be a great use case for something like what you guys are building, because that's something that is a global challenge. That is something that they should open source. It would make the vaccine safer, better, and faster.
I agree. I definitely agree with you. And
are you talking to Donald Trump? Have you guys reached out to Don?
No, we have not.
He listens all the time. I mean, if you were going to say something to him, now's the time.
All right. Well, I'd love to get on a conversation with them and explain to him how we can move forward.
Pretend he's listening. Say, Don, let's make a deal.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it would not only help us, it helped the world. And, we can continue back to our everyday lives that, the lives that we're living pre-pandemic.
So have you guys created a user-friendly, lack of a better word, portal to upload and store this data?
Right. So essentially, we call it like our data warehouse. And it's going to be a marketplace, a website. You go in there, you can start monetizing your data sets, your algorithms. You can, buy someone else's algorithms. And, it's essentially the sharing of innovation and the sharing of like artificial intelligence. That's like at the least or at the core of it, that's what it is.
Artificial intelligence, Skynet. Skynet goes live in a couple of years, 100%. 100%. And unless, unlike the movies where it's this big mechanical Terminator, I'm almost convinced that it's going to be a large fat pig that somehow got Elon Musk's neural brain link embedded in it.
Right.
Yeah. And somehow Skynet got into the pigs and the pigs all started realizing we don't want to be bacon anymore. We're going to take this fucking shit over. So instead of Arnold Schwarzenegger Terminator, I'm going to get chased down by some fat pig. And thank God Jesse likes bacon because he'll save my life every time.
Yeah, that'd be an interesting world.
But trust me, when you start looking at pigs, you got to start looking at those pigs a little bit differently, because according to Elon, he's able to implant stuff to get them to think and be hooked up to the internet. Right. Did you see that thing? Did you see the pig that was hooked up to the internet yesterday?
Yeah, I did. I actually saw it last night. Yeah, it's insane where
it's pretty crazy.
It is. Yeah, and then, Elon Musk is just coming up with anything that, kind of like, he's essentially creating this, like, I don't know if it's a dystopia, if it's going to a dystopia society, or if it is going to go to utopia. Well,
let's be honest. We've verified that aliens have landed on planet Earth. They literally verified that. The DOD said they have found ships that are not made of this planet. I'm going to go out there and I'm just going to say it. Elon Musk is not of this planet. And the reason why he's doing all this spaceship stuff and trying to go to Mars, the motherfucker's trying to get back home. He's trying to embed these neural links into these pigs. So when he goes to Mars, he can send us messages back and the pig will actually talk.
So the future does look something like, pigs ruling the world.
Yeah, it'll be like the Elon Musk pig is about to now go onto Twitter and do a live video. My fellow Americans, I am Elon, but I'm on Mars back home. I mean, he has to be from another planet. He created electric cars. He's got spaceships that are doing cool shit. And now he's got pigs that are plugged into the internet.
Have you seen Jeff Bezos' Blue Origin and his goals as to
what he's trying to do with that? You don't hear much about Blue Origin. It's almost like they're doing secret shit. Whereas what's Elon's project called?
SpaceX.
Every SpaceX project, they got cameras all over that thing. You see everything. It's the coolest fucking shit in the world. Blue Origin, you never hear anything about his shit.
Yeah.
Why? What's up with Blue Origin?
Yeah, so he's trying to essentially create... it's like he's trying to build the infrastructure into essentially like a space city. So it wouldn't be in Mars. It wouldn't be on the moon. It would essentially be like a floating infrastructure where... Well,
don't we already have like a big space ISIS? By the way, don't call something ISIS that you're going to put in outer space. It makes it sound like a terrorist organization. Whose idea was that? I think they call it the International Space Station.
Yeah, I mean, we do have something like that, but I'm like, his like vision is like an actual three-dimensional world where we can actually have like agriculture, spaceships going back and forth from the Earth into this like station. He's crediting the infrastructure being in place such as like USPS, highways, etc.
You're trying to tell me they're going to deliver mail to a space station? Let me tell you something. The mail people already fuck things up on the planet Earth. Getting it to the space station is going to be a nightmare.
No. What I was saying, it's like he credits all of these infrastructures for essentially the growth of Amazon. So he's trying to give back by setting up the infrastructure into outer space.
Yeah, he's not giving anything back. He's probably the most selfish human being on the planet, which is good. Selfishness and greed is good to a degree, but what he's doing throughout this COVID is ridiculous. The one thing that this whole crisis, this master plan crisis has done is for companies like Amazon, the disparaging amount of wealth that has been pushed in their direction and taken away from small businesses is fucking criminal. It is horrible to see how some companies like Amazon, who don't pay taxes, by the way, that's gotta change.
Right.
Somebody's gonna have to tap Jeff on the shoulder and say, "Yo, Jeff, we got to get you in this new corporate tax bracket." Because
I agree. That
has a huge advantage on companies out there.
Yeah, and essentially that's what every catastrophe brings, right? An income inequality gap, a wealth gap.
And it does, but this one's been pretty epic. Like, it's right. been pretty epic.
And we have yet to see the ripple effects. I believe that it's still going to, like, we're probably not going to see it until another year or two.
Now, when you say ripple, I think wine. Are you talking XRP? Just kidding. Shout out to all the weirdos that own that 30-cent crypto token. I don't even think it's crypto. They're just that token that is just the mysterious token that everyone somehow, how do they sell that shit? Like, you ever think to yourself, when they go into a conference room and they talk to a room full of fucking boring bankers and they get these idiot bankers to buy Ripple, whoever's making that pitch has got to be the best salesperson in the world. Like, Ripple has sold $1 billion plus of their shitty fucking cryptocurrency.
Right. I believe their market cap is around 15 billion now.
Is it 15 billion?
I think so.
That's the market cap, but the actual sales, like if you look at their quarterly sales, they've actually sold over $1 billion of that shit to banks.
Huh.
Somebody. I don't even know who they're selling it to.
Right.
Like, I used to think I was a good salesperson, and then I saw Ripple and I'm like, fuck, those guys are, they could sell ice cubes to an Eskimo. I actually think that's what they're doing, is they're selling ice cubes to an Eskimo. They're selling bankers a shitty token that will never be used in the way that they're pitching it. It's the most baffling thing I've seen.
Right. And then there was a dump of the coin, right? If I'm not mistaken. Like last year, where they just essentially put more of the coins out.
It's probably Jed McCallum, you know, bless his heart. He, one of the founders of Ripple, or not Ripple, but maybe XRP, the actual platform itself. And he just sells, I want to say he sells like 1.7 million a day. Like, literally, Jed's just fucking making bank. Like, he's got to be a billionaire by now. Or a couple billionaire. Who knows?
Right.
Yeah, he's just selling Ripple like it's going on. He's like, let me get rid of this shit. He doesn't even believe in that shit. And he was like one of the creators of it. I like Jed, by the way. Jed's been a great guy in the crypto space.
Right. Yeah, I do believe that Ripple is, like, at its core, though. It's like one of the leading, I guess, digital currencies that's like being essentially talked in, like, at the SEC level in regulations. Like, Ripple is one of those tokens that is being investigated if we do decide to go forward and start like regulating digital currencies and allowing this innovation.
Well, they're trying to say that Ripple's a security, which they're probably right, but Ripple's got so much money to buy so many lawyers that, you know, they'll probably find a way to defend themselves. But yeah, I mean, Ripple, first of all, it's not decentralized. It's very centralized. And they're basically just printing an IOU. I mean, it's the worst part of crypto. Like, it's literally insanely bad. But they're doing insanely good, which is crazy. Like, you see shit like that, and you're like, okay, you know, the world is just upside down. By the way, shout out to Bozeman. What's the name? Wakanda guy. What a serious loss. Died last night, 43. Spent the last 4 years fighting cancer. Never even told anyone, I guess. I guess he told, like, you know, 12 people.
Right, yeah. And he's definitely, like, a huge iconic figure, and I believe, you know, he brought a lot of hope into the African American community.
Kind of forever. You know, it's crazy. When I heard it last night, and he was just the guy was like fit. I mean, he looked fit. And you know, just, it's one of those things where he did all this work over the last 4 years. He did all this stuff with his life while he was dying. Like, literally his body was getting attacked by this horrible cancer, and he was in stage four. Like, are you kidding me? He was on chemo. He was probably getting, that was a tough thing to hear, as somebody that spent 4 years fighting stage four cancer, never even let the world know about it, which, you know, hats off to him. That's just a brave human being.
Right. Yeah. You know, it's extremely terrible.
I think people definitely
remember as one of the greats.
I think 2020 is going down as the year of the suck. Like, everything sucks about 2020.
Oh, yeah, 100%. Yeah. Everything about 2020 hasn't been fun so far.
Lost Kobe at 41 years, lost Bozeman at 43 years, and then everything in between just sucks.
Right. Well, you know, just like, I believe there's going to be a rainbow at the end of the storm. I'm just trying to look, be optimistic about
it. Rainbow is like 2021. Like, I'm scared to say this. It can't get worse in 2021, but I'm almost scared to say that because it's like I'm challenging the gods and saying, yeah, you know, hey, you can't do any worse than 2020. And they'll be like, oh yeah? Wait till you see 2021.
Yeah, we'll probably have the pigs come in.
How have aliens not landed and just started, you know, talking to us yet? I mean, like literally, when is that coming? That's gotta be hit coming like in October or something.
Right, no, I agree. You know, I do believe in extraterrestrial.
You have to, I mean, it's fact. Like literally it's fact. Like literally they said, hey guys, while all this stuff's distracting you, we just wanted to let you know we found a spaceship and it's not of this planet.
Right. Yeah. I've studied a lot of like past civilizations. So like the Mayans, the Aztecs, Incas, and, you know, they even have kind of like hieroglyphics of, you know, spaceships and space shuttles and astronauts. So, you know, it's just, we just don't know enough about this world to be close-minded.
Well, I think inside the galaxy or the universe or something, they figured out that there were like 300,000 planets or something. Like there's probably even more. And just mathematically speaking, you can't think that one Earth out of 300,000 planets is the only one with intelligent life. And by the way, I use the word intelligent life when speaking about Democrats, my bad. Just, but if you think about it, like, there's got to be intelligent life elsewhere. It just has to be. Just let's just agree that that's just 100% fact.
Right. No, I agree. I believe we would be too selfish to believe we're the only ones here.
100%.
Right. So
now let's get back to the whole 100%. He's an alien. 100%. He's trying to get back home, which is why he's working on all this shit.
I'm actually extremely stoked just to see like what's the next venture that Elon Musk comes out with.
It's the Neuralink. He's like plugging, you know, radios into people's brains. By the way, I am not signing up for Neuralink either. Like the whole, like, drill a hole in my head and put this little, you know, mechanical shit into my head. Like, what if somebody hijacks my brain? Like, seriously, like, you can hack a Tesla, you can hack a Neuralink.
Right. And you see, that's a great question, because that's where, you know, someone like Cyberbane or the blockchain comes in. To secure the data and, you know, secure cyber attacks on, you know, on, so let's say autonomous vehicles or even on the Neuralink.
Yeah, but I heard Kim.com once talk about security and hacking, and he said something really smart. Nothing is foolproof. That all code is basically ones and twos, and all you have to do is find the right sequence of ones and twos to take over the code.
Right. Well, you know, we are moving forward, you know, past your GPUs, and now we're going to like quantum computing. So,
how crazy is that, huh?
Right. Yeah, that's insane.
Like quantum computing, like it's actually being used. Like crazy that it's being used.
Right.
How is Tony Stark not just popped up and all of a sudden said, "Yo, my name is Tony Stark, and I am Iron Man." And how is there no Iron Man by now? Let's be honest. I've seen the guy. Have you seen the guy like in England that's running around with the like personal aircraft, the suit?
No, I have not.
You got to Google him. It's pretty cool. He's got like this personal aircraft suit where he's got these jets in his arms and basically just scoots around the water. And it's Iron Man, but, you know, like rudimentary version of Iron Man.
Are you familiar with Boost VC?
Yeah, Adam Draper, shout out.
Right, so, you know, his goal is to essentially...
I think he invested in that company, by the way.
What was that?
I think he invested in that company. Now you're making me do this. I'm actually going to go Google it. Fly suit. All right, let's see. There you go. Real life Iron Man. Speed record. All right, here it comes. Here it comes a 4-second ad. Shout out to YouTube for showing their 4-second ads. All right, let's see. Can we share a screen? Yeah, we can. For sure. You're going to see it's embarrassing how many tabs I have open. It's ridiculous. Like, it's almost embarrassing. You see this shit? There's your Boost VC project. So yeah, I mean, that's rudimentary version of Iron Man.
Right. What I'm curious to know, Chris, like what do you think the next technology is going to be?
The next like life-changing technology?
Yeah.
I think we're getting close, very close to having, and so like you've got AI here and you got AI embedded in projects like what's the tube that Amazon sells? Echo, not Echo. What's the
Alexa?
Alexa. Yeah, Alexa, a little spy.
Yeah.
So Alexa utilizes AI to converse and stuff. I think we're very close to having artificial intelligent Alexa type stuff babysit your kids and educate your kids. Like I think the next big thing you're going to see is going to be in homeschooling kids. Cause what we're learning from this crisis is that the school system is fucking horrible and it's horribly managed. And the thing that's missing is having a personal a human being or personal entity teach your kids, because that's the missing ingredient. Like I got a friend of mine, he's got 5 kids at his house and they're all forced to school at home. It's a freaking nightmare. Like you've got his wife running around and just crazy. But I think what you're going to see probably sooner than not, like in the next, when I say sooner, like in the next 2 years, you're going to see artificial intelligence through some sort of device, could be a laptop, could be a tube, could even be like a teddy bear robot of some sorts, engaging with your kids in game and educational activities.
I actually, funny that you bring this up, I believe last week I read something like that on AngelList.
Somebody already came up with it. Yeah. Damn. Here I thought inventing the future.
Yeah, I believe like, yeah, and they're like already commercialized. If I'm not mistaken, I do think that there's some sort of like robotic, personal assistant.
I think it's going to be like an Iron Man where it's like, you know, Jarvis and it's got a human voice. And actually it's not even Jarvis anymore. I went to some girl's voice and, Iron Man like, yo, Jarvis, how's my suit going? Oh, sorry, Tony, you've been peeing in it a lot. So we're going to have to empty out the pisser. You know, I think kids are going to have like this unique, I don't want to call it relationship or attachment, but they're going to like real feel like, you know, the AI is actually human in nature, that it's going to give them a joke every now and then. It's going to seem as human as possible without actually being human.
Right. And COVID has, accelerated us into this future that we're speaking of. Before the kids were going to school, they weren't being consistently, they weren't around these like new environments, right? So like, for example, many households today in the US have some sort of Alexa or, Google sort of like personal assistant at home. And now kids are using that, right? Kids are growing up using cell phones. Kids are growing up, with VR headsets, et cetera. So I actually do believe that sociologically, COVID has accelerated at least that future generation to start thinking this way.
Yeah, I mean, that's just with every generation, we all get more technologically advanced. You know, in the 70s and 90s, there were VCRs and microwaves that everyone was geared up to. now, you know, my buddy's got a three-year-old girl, and we're out one day, and she's like, oh, can I have your phone? And I'm like, sure. And like, you know, it's like all of a sudden, 10 minutes later, she's downloading apps from the App Store. I'm like, God, I'm this old. I'm like, the fuck are you doing? Give me my phone back. So, you know, it cracks me up because technology is getting better and it's actually becoming a part of tomorrow's people, tomorrow's children. And I, as far as what I think the next big technology is going to be, Alexa is going to start teaching your kids 4 + 4 = 9. Mm. And by the way, 100% Alexa is going to teach him that. And then she's going to convince him that 4 + 4 = 9, because Jeff Bezos has got some weird shit going on in this thing.
Right.
By the way, 100% any device in your home that listens all the time is spying on you. So just so you know, that's my theory on whole Alexa stuff.
Right. I mean, you know, now we start having the conversation of like, you know, Edward Snowden brought that up, right? And he essentially lied to, you know, some sort of like, you know, Big Brother surveillance, essentially. So
Big Brother anymore. Everyone's always worried about Big Brother. I actually think you got to worry about the social media platforms and the Silicon Valley mafia, because they're able to almost like, here's something crazy. I'll share the link with you later. Last night I saw something absolutely insane. Like, I almost want to do a whole video about it, but I probably will. Do you know Weinstein, Brett and his brother, Eric, you know, Eric Weinstein, he's got a podcast. You should check it out. It's a good podcast. He does a lot of work with Peter Thiel, and he posted something last night that was like shockingly weird, and I'm looking it up right now. I'm going to Eric Weinstein. There we go. It's the craziest shit I've ever seen in my life, and I. Talking to Jack, you know, such a name dropper. So it's crazy. So there's this thing, there's a link to a thing called articlesofunity.org. Have you checked it out?
Actually, I did. Yeah, I've seen it.
How crazy is that shit?
Right.
Like, Twitter is literally banning the view of a third party political idea. They're literally not letting people see it.
Right.
Tell me that's not election interference.
No, I agree. I agree. And, you know, it, like you said, you know, social media and like these social, I mean, if we look at Amazon, Google, Facebook, right, even Apple, they've all monetized their data, right? And like essentially kept us under control by using these applications. They've become part of our everyday life. So, you know, I do believe that there has to be, you know, applications such as like voice, right? Where like you can now like own your own data.
Wait a second. Are you talking about voice, the EOS project?
Right.
Yeah. Where is that project? Like literally you hear about it, but like you don't hear about it. And then to be honest with you, how the fuck is EOS going to manage voice when they can't even manage transactions?
Well, they just launched. They're past their beta stage, and now they're allowing, you know, multiple countries to, you know, open up their profiles. They currently have like an invite only, sort of, like marketing strategy.
Have you seen it?
Yeah. So I actually have. I mean, I can send you an invite code. I have invite codes left. So I'll go ahead and do that. But yeah, I agree. And you know, in the topic of allowing a third party, I believe, you know, just like how Brock Pierce explains, right? Like, you know, it is the two-party system that has been essentially controlling.
Shout out to presidential candidate Brock Pierce, trying to get that third platform into the conversation.
Right.
It's tough watching him do that because there's so much that is rigged against a, like it's such a rigged system that the two parties have.
Right, and I'm actually extremely excited at the fact that he is the one pioneering this third party. I believe if there is anyone else, it'd be him that can actually make a statement, right? And
not Kanye, come on, man.
What was that?
Not Kanye?
No, not Kanye. No, not at all. Yeah.
Shout out to my favorite person in Colorado. I think he's in Colorado or Wyoming right now.
Yeah, I believe Wyoming, right? Wyoming's his like second.
Yeah, he's got like, I want to say he's got like some 2,000 acre estate out there.
Right, it's crazy. Yeah, I mean, shout out to Kanye, but you know, at the end of the day, I, you know, my support's behind Brock.
I'd love to see Brock do it, but the stack, like the cards are so stacked against him. It's like, it's horrible. I think the best thing that Brock can do with his platform is start a movement towards creating a third platform. We desperately need that third voice in the conversation just to give people a way to disrupt the two idiot parties. Like let's just agree. The Democrats are just fucking horrible. And the Republicans on any given day are equally horrible. And a third voice would be so refreshing, especially if it was a technical voice that had young mindsets. Like some of these politicians, by the way, let's just get this straight out there. Term limits. Let's get these fuckers term limits.
Right.
Like some old twitchy Nancy Pelosi up there talking. I mean, you're way past your expiration date. Get the fuck off the stage. You know, and Chuck Schumer, it looks like the evil character or some like killed children's play or something. You know, get these people that are just too old. When they went up there and they were asking what's Twitch, I'm like, man, shut the fuck up. If you don't know what Twitch is, you don't get the hell out of politics. You know,
right. I think that is the issue, right? Because there is no term limits, we have these backward ideologies, these old conservative ideas, and you know, not allowing innovation to come to place. And never before have we ever seen innovation stride as fast as it has been. And if we don't have new minds, new ideas, you know, we're not going to move forward. And we're starting to see it.
Well, did you see the congressional hearings on cryptocurrencies?
Yeah, I have.
You would swear that the idiots asking the questions had never heard of an iPad or an iPhone before in their lives. Like the questions they were asking were so, they did very little homework in preparation, and they made these Congress people look horribly stupid.
I mean, did you hear the hearings between the Facebook, the Apple?
Oh, Google? Yeah, I loved when like Sinar Pinjay, who I have no love for to begin with, but he's like, he had to like explain to people, okay, well, we don't do that. they're like, well, we're just Google. You know, they're like, yeah, but can't you do this? No, we don't do, we're not in that business. That's Amazon. You might want to talk to, they were asking like questions, and they their technical understanding and their just their basic understanding of technology is like that of a mosquito.
Right. Yeah. And like, you know, I sat through it all, and it was a bit painful to watch.
God, how do you get through all that? I saw like a few minutes of it. I was like, God, get me the fuck away from this.
I clinged on to hope, and I was hoping that it was going to get better eventually. I don't think it ever did. But
shout out to Mark Zuckerberg. I've never seen somebody drink water more weird in my life than Mark Zuckerberg. Like, he drinks water and surfs like a cyborg. Like 100% he's like some sort of cyborg from Star Trek or something. What was it, the Borg? They called him the Borg?
I have no idea.
Oh, you're not a Trekkie?
No.
All right, we'll be ending this conversation right now. It's been nice having you. So anyways, did you see that lunatic on a surfboard? He literally put sunblock 1000 all over his face. Like, seriously, dude. Like, there's sunblock, and then there's just going overboard.
Yeah, no, I did not see that.
And the fact that he had a photographer out there shooting him surfing on a surfboard, that's just weird in itself. Like, come on. Yeah. You know, if you know you're getting pictures taken, don't put sunblock 1000 on your face. You look weird. You haven't seen that picture, by the way?
No.
Google Mark Zuckerberg surfboarding. Like, if you do it right now, I'm not kidding you, you will be like, what the fuck? So anyways, so Twitter's now trying to keep a third voice, a third political voice out of the conversation. And that's kind of creepy weird when you think about it, because, you know, everyone talks about Big Brother manipulating your data. Big Brother can manipulate and spy on you, but Big Social Media Brother or Big Silicon Valley Mafia Brother, they can actually change the world. They can get people elected. They can do things that are downright evil.
Right. No, I agree. I'm a bit confused because I do know that Jack Dorsey is huge like crypto evangelist, not allowing someone like Brock Pierce to have that voice on his platform.
Wait a second, this has nothing to do with Brock Pierce. This has something to do with Eric Weinstein's brother, who is launching this whole third party concept. And it's another third party concept in addition to what Brock's trying to do.
Right, but just taking off that third voice eventually shuts down any, including Brock Pierce, including even Kanye.
Because Brock's like doing something that nobody cares about, because Jack doesn't have to interfere with Brock, because I think the odds are stacked so far against Brock. But this actually had a chance to get people to start questioning something. And the fact that they're blocking it, I was like, wow, that is so crazy. And they blocked it like the day it was created, they started blocking it. And I was thinking to myself, wow, they're actually afraid of people having a third opinion.
Right. Yeah. No, it's insane. And it's, it's sad, especially with what we're going through. And, it's because November 3rd is right around the corner.
Well, what's the problem with having a third conversation? What's the problem of having different thoughts? See, that's the one thing that's really crazy about America today. I talk to friends of mine that have liberal ideas, different thoughts. We talk, I think aliens exist. They might not. We live in a world where it's okay to have dialogue when it differentiates. Like if you all of a sudden, Chris, there's no fucking aliens, I'd be like, all right, sure. That's your opinion, but wait till they come down and wake you up in the middle of the night. But nowadays, if you have a different opinion on something, people get in your face, they go crazy, they lose their mind, they start a mob attack on you on social media. Like I saw a picture the other day, some lady and her husband out there having dinner at a restaurant, and a mob of people are in their fucking face with microphones yelling about Black Lives Matter. That's crazy. Like the world we're living in now is very dangerous, crazy. Like we've got some dangerous, crazy shit happening.
Right, and it's definitely having a toll on our democracy.
Having a toll on our sanity. I think like we're seeing insane shit happening. Like you got people that are getting shot in the head because they were trying to hit some kid with a skateboard. It's crazy. Like you can't even talk about these subject matters without being so really divided down the middle. And it is. Here's the other crazy thing too. You've got professional athletes and, giving their opinions and telling people what to think, which is great. Everyone has an opinion. But when they're trying to, like, create a narrative, now they're just playing puppet master. And that's just that gets weird. Now you got these whole camps of people that are divided down one middle line. And we live in a day and age where people forgot, hey, it's okay. Listen to the other side. You might learn something.
Right. And, and I believe it stems back from these social networks, right?
100%.
If we want to actually dissect the stem of the issue, I believe we should start there. But yeah.
I think what this is all going to lead towards, and something that you guys are working on, is I think we're going to see a decentralized social platform that is usable. Right now, I don't think there's any that are usable, but there's going to be one that comes along that's usable. And when we find that, when we take Jack out of the process, we take Twitter out of the process, we can take away manipulation out of the process. And that's really what the key is socializing data and socializing communication. Not socializing, decentralizing.
Yeah, right, and I agree. And even more so now that we're becoming a globalized society, right? So
what was the word you used?
Globalized?
What is that? What do you mean?
Yeah. So, just as globalization, now we're doing trade, across
Globalized. Yeah. I think I thought you said.
Right. So, you know, and, you know, I believe digital currencies is going to be one of the answers to switching these things around.
Well, I think that's why Bitcoin is such a, like, they, I don't know if they've done Satoshi Nakamoto as Time Man of the Year, but if they haven't done it yet, they probably should, because he, along with all the other core developers, have built something in Bitcoin that is going to change the world we live in forever.
Right.
You know, the fact that there is a currency that takes power away from government, that in itself is game changer.
Right. I agree.
Because right. As we're seeing these last 4 months, governments, when they are in charge of the money supply and the currency, they do some whacked out shit.
I mean, the great example is, like, you know, what happened recently in Lebanon, right? And what has been happening in Lebanon, what has happened in Venezuela, Argentina. Right. So, like, when we do have, like, centralized authorities that are manipulating our the financial institution, and two, just like manipulating society in the way that they want, where, like, society can't even trade overseas, or, like, you know, for example, the residents of Venezuela, the residents of Lebanon, how they can't go out to, you know, their bordering countries and trade. They just can't, right? And, you know, that's a solution that Bitcoin and many of these digital currencies will be solving. And I think that will be, like, the start of this revolution of decentralization, of, you know, a sharing economy. And I'm really optimistic that the future is going to be looking a lot brighter than what 2020 has shown us.
Anything's got to be better in 2020. Like, literally, we could do a plague of locusts in January of 2021, and we're still ahead of the game.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, that's a different conversation too. The locust in Africa. That's, like, everything about 2020 has been, you know, pretty bad.
Crazy is everyone talks about, like, wanting to change, you know, the whole global warming conversation and stuff. The one thing we can control is cleaning up all the fucking plastic that's in the ocean. Like, that's changing currents. It's changing weather patterns. It's killing whales. Let's just clean all the fucking plastic out of the ocean. We can control that. And by the way, China, if you're watching, and I know you fucking watch this show all the time, quit dumping fucking plastic in the ocean, you motherfuckers. China dumps, like, the most plastic in the ocean every fucking year. And these whales, they eat the fucking plastics, their stomachs blow up. It's just gotta be the bottom of the ocean. And there's like plots of plastic float around that I hear about the size of Texas. Like, think about that. A whole plot of plastic the size of Texas.
Right.
Yeah. That's fucking crazy.
Right. Yeah. And then even as well with the oil spills, right. And then, you know, essentially we've been destroying our ocean. And I think
here's the other crazy thing. Nobody talks about it. Remember Fukushima?
Yeah.
Still pouring 2.5 tons of radiation in the ocean every single fucking day. How do we not have a three-headed great white shark that's, like, able to fly like a dragon yet? I mean, seriously, when that fucker comes out of the ocean with wings pretty soon, I am going to be the first person that said, I told you so. Three-headed fucking great white sharks with wings is going to be a thing. Hey. You ever see that movie? I swear to God, it's like it's a classic. It's an old one. It's the who is the guy that was in X-Files?
I have no idea.
He was in Californication, the actor. Oh my God. I'm gonna go look it up. I'll send you the link later. It's this comedy about some rock came from outer space and it started, like, making these creatures, and they had to put dandruff, head and shoulders, because it had a chemical in its pooper to kill this alien. They killed it with fucking head and shoulders up the pooper. When you got a fire engine truck, they used the hose to pour it up its butthole. Funniest movie, like, super hysterical. Long story short is, you know, they had all these things that were evolving. Oh, Evolution. That's the name of the movie. Go, when you get a chance, look it up. It's called Evolution. Fucking hysterical. But it's, if you think about it, you put 2.5 metric tons of radiation into the ocean every day for 10 years in a row. 100% there's something at the bottom of the ocean that's being evolved. Something's changing.
All right. Well, perhaps it's something positive, like the Ninja Turtles or something.
It's
like that.
It's never going to be positive. It's going to be Godzilla. It's going to be flying three-headed great white sharks. 100% it's never going to be positive. It's always going to be something that flies, spits out fucking radioactive flames, and probably kills half of San Francisco. Which, by the way, if you needed another reason to leave San Francisco, Godzilla's coming. Leave now. The only safe place in the planet will be Texas, because Godzilla will not fuck with Texas. Nobody fucks with Texas.
Yeah, it's an interesting world.
Well, I think we've covered it all now. We've gone from cyber vein to three-headed sharks that can fly in Godzilla.
Right, and the revenge of the pigs.
Well, hey, let me tell you something. You start putting like Neuralink into a pig, don't fool yourself. The next Terminator is not Arnold Schwarzenegger. It's a fucking pig with a big ass fucking gun. And believe me, they're going to remember all those fucking people that ate bacon all those years. By the way, Jesse, that does not bode well for you, buddy. Jesse sees one of these Neuralink pigs walking in the neighborhood. He'll be like, fuck, bacon has really evolved. Shout out to Elon Musk. Thanks for putting the internet inside of a pig's head.
Right.
You've now put bacon on the block. Hey, I guess that's a way you can put bacon on the blockchain.
Yeah.
Neuralink. We've just now put bacon on the blockchain. What the fuck? All right. So listen, your project's cool. Definitely want to bring you back in the future when it's live. That'd be cool as fuck. Can't thank you enough for your time. The walk-up music was killer. You got some good walk-up music. What's on your roadmap for the next 6 to 12 months? What are some of the things that we should look for?
Yeah, so definitely look for, or keep bookmark Cybervein. I guess that would be my first advice. Definitely bookmark Cybervein.
Under the video here, people, if you want to find it.
My goal is to bring this innovation into the U.S., have it listed in exchanges where individuals can access our utility token. Because once we do launch the mainnet and this data warehouse, you're gonna have to transact in CBT, which is the ticker token or the ticker symbol of the token.
What's
CBT.
B as in boy or D?
B as in voice.
Oh, vein, as in vein.
Right.
So cyber vein token.
Exactly.
Cool. Right.
So,
what are you guys trading at today?
I believe 6 cents or 5 to 6 cents.
The beautiful thing about 6 cents is you only got 6 pennies to go to zero, but a whole lot to go up.
Right. Yeah. It's it's definitely an exciting moment.
All those tokens that started at zero and are now not zero.
I mean, look at Bitcoin, right? It started at zero. Now it's insane. Right.
Why didn't I buy more? Why didn't I buy more?
Right. Why didn't I buy some?
That's what they're going to be saying about CBT pretty soon. They'll be like, why didn't I buy more? It was at 6 cents.
Right. So, yeah. That's our roadmap is essentially looking, to establish ourselves in the U.S. as...
Hey, I know you watched this video. Give the kid a little hand. Get him on Binance USA. Yeah, have you spoken to Cooley?
No, not yet.
All right, she watches this all the time, so.
Okay.
I'm sure she'll be bringing it to you.
Yeah, so.
Quit playing basketball today. Call the kid up, get him listed.
Right, and if that can happen, that would be, obviously huge. And.
When you say huge, you mean Donald Trump huge, right? Huge.
Right, that's what's next. And then obviously moving forward is to continue to commercialize this. Bring partners.
What are the commercial applications you guys are are working on? Name one.
So that our guest, our main one would be so Dave, right? So the data exchange marketplace. That would be our first, our biggest commercialization platform that we are working on. There's other protocols similar to us, right? So there's like SIA coin. But, you know, there's analysts out there, there's articles that you can, find out or go ahead and research yourself that, you know, essentially we are more commercially available than many of these platforms. So we're definitely expediting our commercialization and, you know, we're growing. And that's the goal, to scale.
Listen, buddy, growing is always good. Not growing sucks.
I agree.
Well, I think data is going to eat the world. So if you're involved in data, your coin, in my opinion, can only go up if you guys execute. If you don't execute, you guys are fucked. like every project in life that doesn't execute, you're fucked.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, everything's looking great for us so far. So I'm extremely excited of, you know, what our future holds for us. Extremely excited. What was that?
How big is your team right now?
I want to say around 15.
It's a good size team.
Right. And we've already, opened conversations with governments, which I cannot disclose, but, we have started these discussions and...
Donald Trump watches this all the time, right?
Well, I hope I can have a conversation with them, and you know, I'm excited to data.
If he's not DMing you on Twitter after this show, I'd be shocked.
All right. Well, I'll definitely look forward to his DM.
You hear that, Don? He'd be like, "So tell me a little bit about this vein. It's at 6 cents. What do you think the possibilities are for 12 cents?"
Right. I mean, if he was able to have an interview with the CEO of Barstool, who's doing pizza reviews, I'm more than sure he should be interested in having a conversation about data and how, you know, we can start monetizing and innovating the United States, which is in huge need right now.
Yeah, we are. I think the United States needs an overhaul of its brain capacity, because the people that are in charge of the technology for America aren't that fucking smart. For a country as great as America, we need to just start firing people that don't understand anything about computers. That includes all the Congress people. We have to start giving them a basic understanding test and say, okay, if you don't know what the fuck Twitch is, just resign after this test because you suck. If you don't know what Twitter is, if you don't know what blockchain is, if you don't know what Bitcoin is, and if you don't know what the fuck Google does for a living, resign.
I guess I'm going to make this proposition. How about this, Chris? We set up an education platform. We go to Congress and, you know, we do a workshop on blockchain, Neuralink, radiation, clean up the ocean.
Listen,
that's a place to start.
If we did that shit and we somehow got into the building, that would be a modern miracle. keep that knowledge away from us. We want to stay in the past. Because trust me, politicians fear the future because they know that it ultimately involves replacing their idiot asses.
I mean, as it should, right? Just like any career, right? There's always going to be an end and there's always going to be a new beginning. And I think just for the best of society and their own generations, I think it would only be the correct thing to do.
Listen, it's evolution. We all have to evolve. By the way, I gotta do this before I let you go. I gotta do this. This would be horrible if I didn't do this. Hold on. Oh my God. Oh my fuck. Okay, what I'm about to show. What? No, I don't want to fucking answer a question. Come on, Jesus Christ. Quit asking me for that. All right. What I'm about to show is probably not rated for children. So if you're a kid, don't turn the volume off. You definitely want to see this. No, just kidding. All right, kiddo. Christian, this is like going to be the part of your day.
beginning. All we're trying to do is take back a piece of what's going on.
Is this true? Are you aware of any of this?
No, absolutely
hey,
not.
There's something in my
you're
suit.
You're not going to believe him. He openly admitted to hacking into our computer.
Something in my suit.
Did you do that?
Harry, what?
You...
Ira, there's something in my suit.
It's impossible. It is sealed.
There's a fly in my suit. Oh, God.
No. No. You're right. Who's the man?
Okay, you're the man.
No, you're the man.
I'm the man.
You're the man.
Okay. Oh,
God. Okay, Harry. Cut him open. Let's get this thing.
Cut me open.
I might be able to catch it in his colon.
How you doing it?
Rectally. There's no time for lubricant.
There's always time for lubricant.
All right, flip it.
Okay, here we go.
You gotta try to relax, buddy.
It's gonna be okay.
I'll shove this gurney up your ass. See if you relax, Ira.
Keeps better.
All right. Going in.
Don't clench.
You're so brave. You're so brave.
No more.
A little deeper.
No! Deeper!
Squeeze my hand. Squeeze it.
Almost there.
Open up.
Breathe.
Open up.
Breathe.
I'm breathing.
Almost there.
You're there!
Oh, it's over.
Just died.
Don't you ever do that again!
You should have seen the size of that thing he had inside. He was like this, man. He took it like a man.
All right. Great.
Can I
get you anything? Do you need anything?
Ice cream. I'd like an ice cream, please. It doesn't matter. It's for my ass.
Oh, by the way, this scene is killer. Shout out for the Spanish subtitles.
If I was a giant, nasty alien bird in a department store, where would I be?
Lingerie.
My huge bird.
Lingerie.
Wait. 100% this is the way we're going to try to communicate with aliens one day.
Don't work.
Right. Sorry.
What do you say, Ira? Pack it in?
You are so beautiful to me. Step back, Harry. I'm gonna shoot him.
No, stand down. I'm gonna kill this one myself.
Give me a chance. I'm communicating here. You are so beautiful to me.
Wayne? Would you please stop, because you are embarrassing me.
Can't you see you're everything? You're everything that I hope for.
There's your flying great white shark.
Yeah, sing, rub some funk on it.
And you're everything I need.
You wrapped it all, I'm gonna get the bird.
Got it.
You
are so beautiful to me. So what do you want? Light meat or dark?
You have to ask. Good now.
By the way, good exit music. If you're not downloading and watching that movie in the next 72 hours, there's something wrong with you. Was it all that I told you it would be?
Yeah. Flying dragons. Yeah.
The whole bug scene. Get out. Like, cut off the leg. Don't cut off the leg. It's going into the colon. Cut off the leg. That whole cast, by the way, they were before their time. Like, there's people in that whole movie that had some unbelievable cast members that just crushed it. Like, they had the right chemistry. You watch that movie today, I'm not kidding you, you'll shit yourself laughing. Or there's something wrong with you. Hey, Christian, thanks a ton for this time. I learned a ton about what you guys are doing, and I find it more interesting as I start peeling away the layers and asking the right questions. So, it's been super interesting learning about this project.
Yeah, definitely. I appreciate your time, and thanks a lot for having me. And, you know, I look forward to having this be an open collaboration moving forward. And if you have any questions, feel free to send them my way.
And if Trump reaches out to you, you'll let us know, right?
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
Cool. So you hear that, Donnie? DM. Your DMs are open, right?
Right, yeah, my DMs are definitely open, especially if it's...
Do him a favor, follow him on Twitter so he can at least DM you, okay?
We'll see.
Yeah, you laugh now, but when you get that message, you'll be like, what?
Right.
Remember, Dave Portnoy can get a conversation with him, why not you?
Exactly, right? And if I can enlighten him on you know, how to use data efficiently and ethically... you know, I definitely believe that that's a step forward.
I will say, if you talk to him about voter fraud and how this fixes that, I think you'll get his ear, because he's all worried about the voter fraud right now.
Right. I mean, well, Brock Pierce is you know, pioneering voting on the blockchain.
He is, but the one challenge that I haven't heard him address is giving people a verified identity. That's the huge challenge right now.
Right. And so there's already platforms like that that are already working on. There's one in SF, their name is Unum ID. And eventually, so what they do is they build a digital identity on top of whichever protocol that you're using, whether it's Ethereum, Tron, whichever protocol you're using, they'll create a digital identity for you.
Really?
Yeah.
They'll do it on Tron?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure they've done it on Tron, Ethereum, Ethereum Classic.
Isn't Tron just a copycat of Ethereum? Didn't they just copy all the basic code concepts off of Ethereum?
I'm not too sure about you know, the infrastructure of their protocol.
Jesse's way of saying goodbye to you. Jesse, say goodbye to Christian. He's right there, like, literally.
Yeah, Jesse.
Jesse's like, oh my god, give me some of that dried pig jerky. Yeah, hey, by the way, enjoy that pig jerky, because when they start getting Neuralink implanted, they're going to come for you.
Right.
All right. Hey, you got a dog?
No, I do not.
Got to get a dog.
No, I love dogs.
Yeah, yeah. San Diego, there's got to be a dog shelter nearby. There's a dog right now in a cage that wants to love you.
Yeah. Is this the way of guilt tripping me?
What'd you say?
It's just a way of guilt tripping into getting a dog today.
I don't even think it's a guilt trip. You got a girlfriend?
Yeah, I do.
Get a dog. You got a girlfriend? Get a dog. She'll love you more. She'll be like, oh my god, cute puppy. I love you so much. So they're the best. They keep you company. You can literally talk to them about you can talk to them about blockchain technology. He'll be like, yeah, dad, sure, no problem. I got you. No, this makes sense, totally. You'd be like, yeah, hey, Jesse, we're talking about blockchain. He's like, yeah, sure. How about another treat? You got any more of that pig? I love pig. Listen, I've had a blast. Did you have some fun?
Yeah, I had a lot of fun.
What are three things that you liked about this talk?
You know, I definitely enjoy the high-level conversation. And
oh, yeah, we went high-level when we went straight to the evolution video.
Yeah, that was the highest we can possibly get, right?
Best thing about that video, there's always time for lube.
And I think we touched on some issues that, you know, definitely do need to get addressed. And we need to have a lot more conversations around this, you know, such as like, you know, climate change, you know, how the dirtiness of our planet, how we're dirtying it, how we're, you know, allowing plastic to reach our ocean. And anywhere from, you know, what the future of technology looks like, and, you know, how we can stop from, you know, Neuralink getting into pigs and having flying pigs. So
yeah, Skynet is now going to be run by pigs that are hooked into the Neuralink.
Right. And, you know, last but not least, you know, I do believe, you know, the bigger picture of everything, I do believe that as of right now, what's extremely relevant is to have that third party and have that third conversation. I believe that, you know, that's probably like the biggest.
I think you guys can make that happen. I think that somehow a third party political platform, I think it's going to have something to do with the blockchain in some way.
Right. Yeah. And I agree. And I do believe that that blockchain technology will be 10 times more impactful than the internet has been. I believe that once you start like changing.
I don't know if it's 10 times more than the internet, because in reality, let's be honest, the blockchain is kind of the new internet. It's internet 3.0.
Right. Well, so the internet brought the information allowed for information to be dispersed. Blockchain will allow value. So, you know, once you bring value into the
value picture. And privacy.
Right. Value, privacy, and security. Right. So.
And it also, the one thing that blockchain does really well is it allows people to take the government out of data, out of money, out of assets, out of privacy, out of, you know, all kinds of things. Voting, hopefully voting. I mean, you know, everyone wants to have clean voting in America. If we can fix that problem in our lifetime, that'd be amazing.
Right. And especially if we can be the pioneers and lead by example, right? Once America like does that, everyone else will follow suit.
Which country do you think will have the first voting on the blockchain tool? I don't think it's going to be America.
No, I believe it's probably going to be, you know, a country out in Europe. You know, perhaps Germany, you know, Scotland, Luxembourg, one of those countries out there.
I think it's going to be a country that's going to somehow have a revolution, because it's going to require a revolution to have that kind of change, because politicians don't embrace that kind of change. I'm going to say it's going to be Venezuela. I think Venezuela is going to revolt and say we can never go back again. And the way we do that is by having voting on the blockchain and make sure that everybody's voice counts. And they're going to probably they're going to embrace the countries that are suffering the most are going to embrace Bitcoin the most also.
Right. I agree. I definitely agree.
So let's see if it's either the Krauts in Germany, which by the way, I'm German, so I know Kraut is probably offensive to some people, but we eat a shit ton of sauerkraut. Like we're the sauerkraut capital of the world. And, or the people in Venezuela who desperately need freedom. They desperately need freedom from the government controlling their money, freedom from the government controlling their country.
Right. Yeah, and you know, it brings voice to the oppressed. And that's what we need. So, yeah, you know, let's continue to push this technology forward, Chris.
Couldn't agree with you more. Christian, thanks a ton, man. By the way, if Donald Trump, Elon Musk, or any of the celebrities we talked about in this cast reach out to you via Twitter, just let me know, okay? We'll do it. It's Dave Portnoy. I mean, Dave, if you're watching, which I know you watch this shit all the time, let's go grab some pizza and talk some life.
Awesome. Thanks a lot, Chris. Really appreciate your time.
All right, hold on, buddy. We're just going to say goodbye to everyone on YouTube real quick. Bye, everyone on YouTube.